Hey there. So today we are going to be discussing the proof for the power rule for fractional powers, and you may not have seen this before. So we all are familiar with the proof for the power rule. If the power is a positive integer, so like 1, 2, 3, so on. And maybe if you're keen enough, you may have tried it for negative powers as well. But have you ever seen the proof for fractional powers? So let's get to it. So we want to find the derivative of x to the power f, where f is a fractional number between 0 and 1. So f is an element of this set. So you may be saying that we are actually supposed to make this into a open set, because 0 and 1 are not fractions. Like, technically they are, but not really. So we'll exclude those two, but we will need to assume that f can be 1. You will see why. So I'll not keep it open on both sides. I'll close it on one side. Okay. Right. So the very first step in this proof is to use the first principle. So what does the first principle say? It says that f prime of x, which is the derivative of f of x, is the limit as h goes to 0 of f of x plus h minus f of x all over h. And in this case, we want to find x to the f prime. So our function is x to the f. So this is equal to the limit as h goes to 0 of x plus h to the f minus x to the f over h. So this is what we have to evaluate. This is what we are concerned about. So how do we do this? Well, I don't know. We need to think of something, because with integers, the good thing was, if this f was an I instead, then what we could have done is we could have expanded this x to the h out, but we don't really know how to expand fractional powers. And if you say that you do know how to expand fractional powers, and you mean to say something like 1 plus x whole to the n is equal to 1 plus n x plus n minus 1 over 2 factorial x square plus dot 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 for x mod x rather being less than 1 and n being any real number. This is true, but this actually is a Taylor series, and where this comes from is this formula. So to derive this, you need to know the derivative of x to the f. So if you use this formula to derive the derivative of x to the f, you're saying that the derivative of x to the f is f times x to the f minus 1, because it is f times x to the f minus 1. And that makes no sense. You're just making a circular argument. So you're just using a result of this fact to prove this fact, which is not fair. So we can't use this, and we can't use this. This is what we have to prove. So this is not something we can use. We have to use something else. So we want to expand out this thing, but we can't really do that. Well, how about we look at some other fraction? So let's say f is a fraction. Let's call it some fraction. F is some fraction, which is in the interval 0 to 1. So, well, even f by 2 is some fraction, right? Some fraction, which will be in the interval 0 to half, right? I can say this. And well, f by 2 is also in the interval 0 to 1. Because if it's in the interval 0 to half, that also means it's in the interval 0 to 1. So whatever is applicable to f is also applicable to f by 2. So why not do this? How about we call this thing some function of f? So let's say g of f. So now g of f is a function of f which spits out the derivative of x to the f for any given f. So for example, if f was half, then g of f, if we would use the power rule, like we are pretending we don't know the power rule for, but for just a minute, pretend that we do. So then if f is 0.5, then g of 0.5 will be 0.5 x to the 0.5 minus 1. I don't have space. So basically you get the idea, right? G of 0.5 is 0.5 times x to the 0.5 minus 1. This is what the power rule says. So we are calling this entire limit as g of f. Okay, so now where does this come in? So well, if we can, and we also need to notice one thing, that the domain of g of f is by definition 0 to 1. So it can only take in values from 0 to 1. And that means that if g can take in the input f, which is between 0 and 1, it can also take in the input f by 2, which is also in the interval 0 to 1. So how about we find a relation between g of f and g of f by 2? Well, for that we'll need some space, so I'll be right back. Okay, so this is what we got so far. And now we were talking about g of f by 2. So let's see what g of f by 2 is. So, well, let's talk about g of f first. So g of f is equal to, now I won't write this limit thing again and again. You can just assume that whenever I write h, the limit of h goes to 0. So, well, g of f is x plus h. And since we want to bring in f by 2 somehow, we can just multiply and divide the power by 2. So we'll do f by 2 and then square the entire thing. Fair enough. And we'll once again do the same thing over here as well. So we are basically dividing and multiplying the power by a factor of 2. So g of f is this. And now to bring in g of f by 2 somehow, we can write g of f. We can factorize this thing because this is a difference of squares. So this is x plus h to the f by 2 minus x to the f by 2 over h, and then the entire thing into x plus h to the f by 2 plus x to the f by 2, and there's no over h over here because we only had one h, so we put the h over here. And now look what we have, because this entire thing is g of f by 2. And this is, of course, very easily evaluatable because we can just plug in limit as h goes to 0 directly over here, and then this will just become x to the f by 2, right? And then this entire thing just becomes 2x to the f by 2. So g of f is equal to g of f by 2 times 2x to the f by 2. And this kind of makes, like, this kind of reminds me of something. Like, maybe we can replace 2 with a generic natural number n. So let's try to do that. Okay, so now let's do the same thing but with n this time. So if f is some fraction in the interval 0 to 1, then f by n is some fraction between 0 and 1 by n. And well, that also means that it's between 0 and 1. So we can say that if we can put f inside g, like if f can be an argument inside g, then f by n can also be an argument inside g. So using that fact, we can now look at g of f by n and somehow relate g of f and g of n. So let's do the same thing again. G of f is x plus h, and since we want to bring in f by n, somehow we'll just put f by n in by brute force and do this. X to the f by n whole to the n all over h. And now we can factorize this, because you can also write this as
x to the f by n whole to the n times, and I'll do a big bracket this time, x plus h over x entire thing to the f by n, and then that raised to n minus 1 all over h.
Okay, now take a moment to realize that this is completely fair, that all I've done is factorized x to the f by n whole to the n out. So now we can use an identity, because if you remember a certain identity, a minus a to the n minus 1 over a minus 1 is equal to 1 plus a square plus dot 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 plus a to the n minus 1. And that means that if we take this a minus 1 to the other side, then we will get a to the n minus 1 is a minus 1 times 1 plus a plus dot 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 a to the n minus 1. And now using this fact, we can factorize this thing, because if we let a equal x plus h all over x to the f by n, then we can use this identity. So I'll get rid of this and I'll be right back. Okay, so this is what we got so far, and now let's continue. So we were letting a equal this entire thing inside these brackets. So what we can do is we can use the expansion. So we'll get x plus h over x to the f over n minus 1, and then that entire thing times 1 plus h over x to the f by n plus dot 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 plus x plus h over x to the f by n times n minus 1. And I know I wrote that really small, so I hope you can see that, but you know what I've written, right? So basically we are calling this entire thing in the brackets as a, and then we are using this expansion on it. And we also had this factor of x to the f by n over here, x to the f by n whole to the n, and now we can distribute it back in. So well, if we distribute 1 x to the f by n inside this bracket, then we will get x plus h, and we also had a factor of 1 over h, so sorry for forgetting that. And now once we put this entire thing inside, then we will get x plus h to the f by n, and then this gets cancelled out with this, and we get minus x to the f by n over h times x to the f by n times n minus 1, because we are basically distributing x to the f by n times n minus 1 inside this bracket. So this 1 becomes this, and then one of those cancels out with this, and we get x plus h to the f by n times x to the f by n times n minus 2 and dot dot dot. So now notice that this thing is just g of f by n, and what is this? Well, here we just have additions and we don't have any denominator, so we can just plug in h equals 0 into here, and basically each term will become just this thing. Each term will become x to the f by n times n minus 1, because the sum of the powers of x plus h and x is equal to f over n times n minus 1. You can check it for yourself, and we'll just keep getting this dot dot dot. And if you realize, we have n terms over here, so we will get this n times. So this term is repeated n times, so this will become n times x to the f by n times n minus 1. So this is one factor, and the other factor is just g of f over n. So g of f, we found out, is equal to this, because g of f is what we started off with. So now we can use this to find g of f by n. We can solve for g of f by n, and we will get g of f by n is g of f
over n times, and since we are taking this to the other side, we are basically negating the power. So this will become x to the f by n times 1 minus n. And this is what we are going to use to do the main part of the proof. So I'll get rid of this and I'll be right back.
Okay, so this is what we got so far. And this is, as I said, what we are going to be using to do our further derivation. And now the key part comes in. And now this is why I said that f is an element from 0 to 1 with 0 not included, but 1 included. You'll see why. That is because we are now going to put f is equal to 1. So in the beginning, if I made it a completely open set, then I wouldn't have been able to do this. But since I allowed 1 as an input, I can do this very legally. So now let's put f equal to 1, and we get g of 1 over n is g of 1 over n times x to the, now f is equal to 1, so this becomes 1 over n times 1 minus n. And you can simplify this to become 1 minus 1 over n minus 1. And now how is this useful? Well, realize what g of 1 is, because we've defined g of f to be the derivative of x to the f. So this implies g of 1 is the derivative of x to the power 1. And this is just the derivative of x, which we can easily derive using the first principle, because the x's cancel out, you just get h over h, which is 1. So this thing, g of 1, is 1. So we can say g of 1 over n is 1 over n times x to the 1 over n minus 1, and tada, the power rule. But now you may ask me the question that not every fraction is of the nice form 1 over n, where n is a natural number. And I know we can fix that. So firstly, notice that every rational number is of the form 1 over n plus 1 over n plus dot 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 plus 1 over n some, let's say, m number of times. And what I'm basically saying is every rational number is of the form m over n. And I can write m over n as 1 over n plus 1 over n plus 1 over n, so on m times. So basically, I can use the product rule on x to the 1 over n prime. Or a better way, a better thing which I can do is I can write x to the m over n primed as x to the 1 over n whole to the m, and then that primed. So doing this, I can just use the chain rule, because I know what the derivative of let's say y to the m is, because m is an integer. So obviously I know what this is using the good old power rule. This is my to the m minus 1. And then I can use that using the chain rule. I can differentiate this very easily. So all rational numbers are covered. And now we get to the irrational numbers, which are always trouble. So what we can do for the irrational number is we can always represent an irrational number as an infinite series, which is summing only rational numbers. So what I basically mean by that is, let's say you want to find the derivative of x to the pi. Well, as I already said, we separate pi out into its integer part and its fractional part. So its integer part is 3 and its fractional part is 0.1415, so on. So we can just write that as pi minus 3. So pi minus 3, or maybe I'll just write it as 0.1415. I think it's 926. And then after that, I don't remember the digits. So whatever. So basically, we want to find the derivative of this thing, right? Because this is already covered. We know how to do this. We can use the product rule later on. But we have a problem with this. So what we can do for this is we can write this as x to the 0.1 times x to the 0.4 times x to the 0.04 x to the 0.001. So basically, I'm taking the digits, and I can represent this as an infinite series, and then I can use the product rule on that infinite series, and I will get this and this exact same thing. So, turn up. Let's go.